gang. It's Saturday the 18th of February 2017. Welcome to today's United Kingdom tour, boys and girls. Now, I've got my other little microphone on again here today. Carl Waring, who's up in Yorkshire, reckons it doesn't sound as good as the other one. Now, I've got the other one here, right? But people have a certain person, Ray Reynolds, has been moaning because you can see the little thing there. He thinks that looks very unprofessional. So, can I just swap between the two microphones and you can tell me which one sounds the better, okay? So, all right, so if you wouldn't mind doing that little piece of technical assistance this morning. All right, so this is a little one here, okay? Look, okay, that's the little one there. If I count to 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I'm now going to swap to the other one, okay? All right, this might be a bit louder. There we are. This is the other one. So, do you prefer microphone 2? Or do you prefer microphone 1? Shall we do it again, boys and girls? Oh, this is so amateur, isn't it? It's like amateur radio. Do you prefer microphone 1? Or do you prefer microphone 2? I'm now back at 1. Please set your votes in immediately. We need to know what you prefer, okay, my darlings? Early people with us today. Good morning to Shania, who has at last got a day off. Poor old Shania, you'll work yourself into the grave, Shania. You will, my lovey. Good morning to Gustav. Thank you, Gustav. Button pressed, thank you. I never remember, do I? Morning to Lee David King. Good morning, Lee. It's a while since I saw you. Now, we got a request from Lee, which I saw earlier. One moment, please. Let me bring that up for you. Lee is requesting prayers this morning. Where are we now? So, please say a prayer for my boy, Herbie Kern. That would be nice. Now, who is Herbie Kern, Lee? I'm not sure. Is that a person, darling? Is that a person or what is it? Do let us know, Lee, and we will say prayers for you. So, prayers requested by Lee David King this morning. Morning, Lee. Nice to see you, sir. All right. Good morning to Adam Tubero, who says, stand by 4 minutes. Those 4 minutes have now passed, I'm pleased to say. Morning to Claire. Morning to Terry H, who's got his mug. Good, Terry. I hope you're drinking out of it now. Whenever you watch one of these shows, you must drink out of your United Kingdom Talk mugs. Yes, we were giving those away a little while ago. If you didn't hear it was announced, I'm afraid they've all gone now, my darlings. Okay. There we are. And that's all our little messages coming in at the moment this morning. All right. Lee says it's his partner who has cancer at the moment. So, okay. So we need to say prayers for his partner there. All right, my darlings. Thank you. Adam says 2 is louder, but more of an echo. Ah, that might be because the volume is a bit too much. 2nd is louder. Gustav prefers number 1. Shania number 2. Lee number 1. Terry number 2. Oh, Lord. So it's about a 50-50 split, dear. Oh, you can't win. Unlike the European referendum last year, which was not a 50-50 split, was it? Oh, and don't they go on. There was my enormous disappointment yesterday when I turned on the television and he's back. Like a bad smell that won't go away. There he was, bleating away again. Bleh, bleh. Tony Blair is back, boys and girls. Oh, and is he looking haggard? You would have thought with all that cash that he's a millionaire, isn't he? He's got all that money. You would have thought with all that cash, he would have had something done to his face. Cool, dear. You know who he reminded me of? That bloke in the horror films, in the Hammer films. Not Vincent Price, the other one. Oh, Lord. He had sucked in cheeks. He looks just like him now. You could see him going like in a torture film, like Hostel or something like that. There he was, bleating away. And whichever side of the fence you're on, doesn't matter. Listen, lovey, Tony lovey, I think you've left it a bit late. It's only a couple of weeks and they're going to instigate the Article 50 thing, whatever that is. We don't really understand what it is, did we? We don't. But he's a bit late. Cold it. Shouldn't you be doing all this 12 months ago, lovey? Are you keeping up with us all, Tony? God's sake. So very, very disappointed to see him back on the telly. And my personal views on him are, you've had your turn, love. Go away. We don't want to see you anymore. It's a bit like him in government, you know. He hung on there, didn't he? He hung on there. Should have gone ages ago. Should have gone at year 10. Hang on for another 2 years, only to be handed over to that dreadful, that ghastly man, George Brown. You know, with a fake smile. George Brown with a fake smile. Ghastly man. I think prime ministers should not be allowed to go longer than 10 years. It all starts going a little bit wrong for them then. Even Margaret Thatcher, it started going wrong for her at about year 10, didn't it? 10 years is gone. That's it. So please, buzz. And what was it? We must rise up. What do you want? Civil unrest, dear? We don't want fighting in the streets because of what you've said. Go away, Tony Blair. We don't want to know. Go away. Keep your mouth shut. Do you know what it is? I don't think he's got anything to do. He's looking for another job. Didn't he leave that European thing, whatever that was he was doing? And the Middle East, he was doing a peace thing there. Hasn't he left all that? He's bored. That's what it is. He's bored. If you're that bored, Tony Lovey, why don't you just start up a new YouTube channel? You'll have thousands of viewers watching that. People who think you can rescue them out of poverty, darling. But you won't be able to, will you? Or maybe McDonald's. I think McDonald's would be a bit of an eye-opener for you to see how people really work hard. Yes. McDonald's are always looking for people, Tony. I can't even see that there. Do you want fries with that? Yes, please. Or you could... I don't know if you'd be on the front. I think you're probably better off at the back cooking. You know, because people aren't going to want to buy something from something that... people aren't going to want to buy food from someone who looks half dead. Are they? Tony? Yeah, Tony, the next one's without the gherkins. Now, no relish on that one, Tony. And then, or if you're no good at the cooking, you can always clean the toilets out, lovey. There is a job for you, Tony. Tony, you do have a place. I know that you're feeling a little bit left out at the moment after you were so, so important for so, so many years. But there is a place for you in this world, my love. There is. There is. Perhaps, Tony, you could set up your own business in Liverpool. In Liverpool. Because Liverpool Council have got the right idea. Now, I'm liking this. I'm liking this. Liverpool, this is on the BBC. No, we don't often refer to the BBC website, do we? No, we don't. The BBC website. People who film or photograph fly tippers and responsible, irresponsible dog owners. That's obviously not the... That is some of the dog owners, incidentally, but not all of them. Will not have to pay council tax. Liverpool Mayor has pledged. They won't have anything coming in at all. How many people are going to see this? What a good idea. What a blooming good idea. Joe Anderson said he was getting so angry. His little old fat head was going bright. Is he a council person? Let's see who he is. Oh, it's Liverpool. Oh, it's a mayor. Oh, they're very, very... Mayors are very, very important people, aren't they? Very, very important. They walk around with their clipboards. Oh, I'm very, very important. I'm very, very important. Joe Anderson said he was getting so angry about dog mess and litter. He needed the public's help to help identify culprits in the act. Now, I actually quite like this idea. The thing is, how far do you want it to go? He said the plans were about boosting civil pride in the community. Not that sort of pride, dear. Not gay pride, no. Oh, look, all the gays, their little ears have just pricked up at the word pride. They think there's there's another big party about to go happening. No, not that sort of pride, I'm afraid. Not that sort of pride at all. The city's Liberal Democrats lead... Oh, they're back, are they? Oh, a Liberal Democrat leader. Are they in one of the councils? Has that started again? The Liberal Democrats Club. Bless them, darling. I like watching their thing on the telly, their annual... what is it called? Conference. You see the Labour conference, right? massive hall, packed to capacity. And they're all shouting and screaming at each other. Can't decide whether to go left or right or stay in the middle. Then you get the conservative one, packed again, slightly on the right, I suppose. And then there's the Liberal Democrat one, great big hall, four of them sitting in the front. Why do they bother, for Christ's sake? Why do they bother? Tony, here's a job for Tony Blair. Why don't you take over the Liberal Democrats party? They could do with a little bit of a bolster in their numbers, lovey. Huh? Huh? Oh, dear. The city Liberal Democrats leader, Richard Kemp. Richard Kemp? No, it's not ringing a bell, that one. No, no. Is he Martin Kemp's brother? Is it anything to do with Spandau Ballet? Gold! Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da! You know that song. He's great, isn't he? Martin Kemp on Let It Shine. I love that programme. Tonight on BBC One. Colour, yes. The City Liberal government was unconvinced by the proposals. Mr Anderson pledged to give those whose evidence leads to a prosecution free council tax for a year. Ah, now you're listening, aren't you? Suddenly it's not such a bad idea. All those people that were saying, oh, terrible civil liberties, tilter, suddenly I've said that. Oh, actually, maybe not so terrible. All led by money, every last one of you, aren't you? Led by money, dear. Aren't you? It doesn't exactly say how many photographs you'd have to provide to get a year's council tax. I mean, surely not, you know, sort of a young child was walking down the street and you got the sweet wrapper dropping out of their hand onto the floor. Snap. Would you send that in and get free council tax? My suggestion is to you, don't send that in, because then someone's mother... Hey, you're taking pictures of my kids. You're taking pictures of my kids. Don't take pictures of my kids. It'd be a bit like that. I wouldn't risk that one if I were you. No. He said, I'm asking people to please help us and provide us with information on anybody you see allowing their dog to foul the streets and provide us with an address where they live. Oh, you've got to follow them home. You've got to follow them home. Oh, I'd love to be followed home at some point, dear. It never happens. Never happens. You know, open my door and then close the door. Look, and then there's a knock at the door. And I open the door and Cristiano Ronaldo's standing there in his football shorts. Oh, dear. Oh, it's all too much. It really is. Mr. Kemp said he did not think many fines would be gained under the plans. He said he was glad it was being acknowledged, but I don't think it's the right way. I would employ more dog wardens. No, you won't, because you won't spend the money, dear. The councils haven't got the money to spend money on dog wardens and rubbish things, and they can't even collect the rubbish more than once every couple of weeks now. Some councils once every 4 weeks. And there is part of the problem as well with the fly tipping. Councils are only collecting rubbish now every couple of weeks, or some are trialling every 4 weeks. What do you think's going to happen with the rubbish? Are people going to take it all the way down the dump in their little cars and get rid of it like that? Of course they're not, you idiots. They're going to dump it everywhere. And it's the same with the rubbish from building sites and all that sort of thing. Councils charge builders, tradesmen, for dumping their rubbish. They charge them for it. If it was free, as it used to be, do you really think there would be as much fly tipping as there is now? No, it's because they don't want to pay to have it dumped, isn't it, you idiots? How do you know where a load of wallpaper and plaster have come from once you find it dumped in a nice, quiet country lane somewhere? You don't know where that's from. Most of these builders are clever enough not to make sure that there's no address or old letters or anything else with that in. Because councils do go round to these dumping places and they will look through the stuff to see if they can find any sort of evidence, maybe an old letter, you know, with an address on it or something like that. They do look. But on building materials, you don't find. I mean, who's going to have an address on a load of old wallpaper? It's not there, is it? And that's part of the problem with the fly tipping. I'm sure it's a major part of the problem with the fly tipping. Even round here from Bracknell, if I, not as a builder, as a resident, if I want to get rid of certain stuff now down at the dump, I have to pay. One of those things is plasterboards. If I was to do some DIY in it, which is unlikely, let's be honest, Mike, you don't want me coming round doing DIY. Doesn't work for me. It really doesn't work for me. But if I did, and I plasterboard, take it down the dump, oh yeah, okay, well, we'll weigh that then. Yeah, that's 30 quid. I don't know how much it costs. I've never had to dump the stuff. So rather than doing that, people like myself, well, not myself, but people who do DIY, do you think they all take it down the dump? Of course they don't. They put it in black bags. They go along to some lay-by somewhere, middle of the night, open the door, put the bags out, close the door, drive off. Costing the council even more than they would have done if they'd have just done it for free. Absolutely ridiculous. I wonder what you think on that, boys and girls. What would be the answer? Would you go out and take photographs either of people's dogs pooing on the grass, which, let's be honest, is disgusting. It is absolutely disgusting. And then some people, they do pick it up with a bag and then throw the bag in the bushes. What's all that about? What the hell is all that about? Would you go out with your camera knowing that you could save, I don't know what your council tax is, mine's about £1,000 a year. 900, £1,000. Some people in London are paying an awful lot more than that. Would you take a few photographs of people's dogs pooing or fly tippers in order to save yourself £1,000 on your council tax? Lines are open now if you want to call in, boys and girls. It's 020 8144 3477. If you're watching the show live, a phone number has now appeared at the top of the picture, along with the United Kingdom Talk logo. 020 8144 3477 is the phone number. Would you go around taking photos? Maybe you have before. Have you ever reported someone for fly tipping, dog pooing, dropping rubbish, anything like that? 020 8144 3477 is the phone number. There is also a Skype in, gang. Okay, if you've got Skype, then you can call in on the Skype. And a Skype call-in number is, all one word, United Kingdom Talk. Skype call-in number, all one word, United Kingdom Talk, okay? Good morning to Joss, who's in Australia, in a lovely little place in Australia. Good morning, Joss. Hope you're well. Liverpool will have a rise in stalker arrests. Yeah, you could be right there, Joss. I mean, is it a nice thing to do? Presumably, if you don't like your neighbour, there's your perfect opportunity to get back at them, isn't it? But you've got to have photographic evidence. You can't just ring up the phone and say, oh, hello. Yeah, Joy. The lady from number four, yeah, she just dropped some rubbish. I saw it. No, you need the photograph. No photograph, no cash. Good morning to Kevin Webster, who's here this morning. Joanna's watching live from her hospital bed in St. John's Hospital. Good morning, Joe. Good morning to Jake Riley. Good morning, Jake. Nice to see you as well. Timothy Thomas is with us. Morning, Timbo. Timbo. And Lee, we've spoken to already, okay? So that's the story on the Liverpool thing. I quite like the idea. I won't lie. I do like the idea of taking pictures, not necessarily for the money, but it might stop people making disgusting messes all over the place. We got a call coming in. Adam the Plumber is on line 76. Good morning to Adam the Plumber.
Good morning, Chris Whedon.
How are you today? All right?
I'm very well, thank you.
You're not out there about to drop rubbish somewhere, are you?
No, not yet. No, I'm just I'm phoning up number one to lock up my Chris Whedon points for the flight to New York.
Oh, yes, Chris Whedon points for the flight to New York. So that's one call. We might be giving away a flight to New York, boys and girls. So that's one for Adam. Who was the other bloke who rung the other day? I didn't write it down, dear. I think it was Wayne, wasn't it? It was Wayne.
Yeah. tiny for the first time. So 1.6.
Right. So I'm going to... So that's... where's my bit of paper? Just a minute. I can only find sticky labels here for some reason. I'm just surrounded in bits of paper. My paper's building up again on the side. You know what I mean by that, don't you?
Yes, I do.
So it was Wayne. This is for the plane to take to New York.
Yep,
plane to take... Just a moment. Take to New York. York... What, just a minute. Wayne M. 1. Adam T. 1. Sorry, Adam, but I can't include... We're not backdating the calls, if you see what I mean.
No, of course not.
Otherwise, you would have won by a mile. Otherwise, Adam, you would have, dear.
Yes, indeed.
Good morning.
Good morning. So, fly tipping. I once got accused of fly tipping.
Sorry?
I got once accused of fly tipping by a neighbour.
Oh, yes?
Yeah, basically, I was working for this company and got to the end of the day and sort of tidied up my van of my food cartons and scroungings from the day and little drink bottles and what have you. Put them all in the caravan and simply popped them in the wheelie bin around the corner outside my house where I was living.
Right.
Next day, I get a phone call from my boss. You've been accused of fly tipping. Give me a being accused of fly tipping.
What, into a bin?
Yeah. You were seen in Brighton tipping rubbish into a bin. I went, whereabouts is this? And they gave me the address. And I said, that's outside my house. I was hiding up my van. And this neighbour had actually phoned in my company and thought I was actually fly tipping rubbish from my van.
Didn't the neighbour know that it was your van?
Obviously not. Didn't bother coming out to ask me what I was
doing.
Yeah.
Blooming busybodies, dear. Busybodies, that's what they are. Have you ever seen fly tipping going on?
Say again, sorry.
Have you ever seen fly tipping going on?
I've seen the aftermath of it, yeah. There's you take, for instance, Croydon. Lovely place, Croydon.
Oh, what a dump, dear.
Yeah, well, just by... The only thing it's got going for it is IKEA, really. But next door to IKEA, there's an old factory that closed down several years ago. And there is a, how can I put it without putting a thing on it? There are a certain set of families that live near the...
Ghastly people?
Ghastly people, yes. That live in mobile homes, let's put it like that.
Oh, mobile homes are all right. Homes are okay, dear.
They go around in transit vans offering to clear your rubbish for you for a cheap price.
Oh, dear.
I think you know where I'm going with that one.
Yes.
Without saying it. And this area must cover the size of 3 or 4 football pitches, the car park area that used to be.
Right.
And it is just literally about 6 foot high in fly tipping. Where
terrible.
They've dumped all the rubbish. Where they've been around, made their money. So... You think how much money they're making from that and how many thousands it's going to cost the council to clear it.
Oh, it's terrible. I've seen people leaving their dog mess. I've never said anything, to be honest. But
no.
I've seen that before. And it's horrible, you know. I mean, to be honest, we used to get it in the 70s. It used to be all over the pavement. Oh, it was terrible. You'd be walking home and say, oh, you've gone in it again. You know, even worse, if you haven't got shoes on. Oh, because
yeah.
It comes, you step on it and it comes up between your toes, doesn't it? Oh, how awful.
It does indeed. Mm. I mean, I did actually see somebody the other day, one of their dogs fouled and they picked it up, scooped it up in a bag and dumped it in somebody's wheelie bin.
That's what I mean. Well, that's okay, isn't it? As long as it goes in a bin. Actually, I've got a neighbour like that. He's not in my row of houses. But if he finds someone's put something in his bin, he chucks it out. I mean, what's the difference? The bin's going to be emptied.
Yeah.
Bin's
well,
a bin, isn't it?
I don't know. Would you like dog mess in your wheelie, in your nice pristine wheelie bin that gets washed?
Well, my wheelie bin is very clean and I have a bin liner in the wheelie bin. My bin liner. I can't bear people with dirty bins. Oh, it's disgusting, dear. And they don't clean them out for so long that the bottom of it starts hardening. So you've got hard bits of food and paper in the bottom of the bins. Clean them out, for God's sake, man. Awful.
Indeed. Yeah, but I mean, it is a very big problem with fly tipping and with general dumping of rubbish because, as you know, I do building and maintenance work. And I recently helped a friend dump some rubbish. And because there was quite a lot of it, I used my van. You know, I was quite able to use my work van. I got permission. And I got down to the dump and said, "You're a builder." "No, I'm not. I'm helping a friend out." And I had to actually produce my certificate for dumping rubbish. It's a trade waste transfer to say what sort of rubbish that I was dumping, and it wasn't on the list, so they knew that I wasn't dumping stuff for work, you know, because it wasn't the sort of materials that I would dump for work, like earth and stuff from dig ups. And it was very difficult. It took me a good 3/4 of an hour to an hour to explain and to get the proof, and to, you know, the person that was with me had to show their address and their proof, and it was all sort of going backwards and forwards. So I can understand why cycling goes on, because it is extremely difficult to dump it legally, as it were. You know.
Well, I don't know. Do you know how much it costs to dump this stuff? Is it a very expensive thing to do?
Well, if you're doing it commercially, Wandsworth, just by the Thames in Wandsworth, there's a big recycling plant there. And they charge a minimum charge of £70 per load.
Right. Gosh, that's a lot of money, isn't it?
It's done on waste. But the minimum charge is £70. And then, obviously, once you go over a certain weight, then it goes up.
Yes.
So you can understand why somebody will say, "I'll clear your rubbish for £100. You know, and you think, "Oh, yeah, that'd be lovely." But what they don't realise is if that's a full load, more than likely they're going to be dumping it somewhere legally. Yeah. Illegally, sorry. Because obviously, you know, you can't dump an entire van load for around about £70. That's the minimum charge. So you're not going to sort of, you know, just charge £30 for clearing all that rubbish.
No, it's an awful lot of money to dump that stuff, isn't it?
I must admit, what I try and do...
Are you on that speakerphone or what?
I am, unfortunately. If I put it on the other
you're
one,
going then, in and out, Adam. That phone of yours is terrible. You've got an iPhone 7 Plus, haven't you?
Yeah, iPhone 7 Plus.
It's really bad. Here, up and down it's going. One minute you're in the red light and then it goes down. I've got like a meter in front of me. It goes between 1 and 7. One minute you're at 2 and then it goes up to 7 and then comes back down again. It's in and out. Those bloody iPhone 7 Pluses are a nightmare. My mate's got one, and I asked him, "Are you moving your head around?" And of course he gets annoyed and I can't. Yeah. And he says it's because my earring's going, and it's not.
No, no. There are some sort of problems with these iPhone 7s. I don't know what it is. I'm thinking of actually trying my headphone set, you know, the headphone with the microphone set, and using that and see if that makes any difference.
Oh, you've got one of those, have you?
Well, yeah, it comes with it, you know, the headphones that come with it. With the little thing
that hangs down by your chest.
Yeah, that's it. So I might try and get one of those.
I wouldn't think that made any difference. What you need is a microphone right in front of your mouth so that it doesn't move. It's just that damn phone. One of the best phones we've got calling in is young Danny Davis in Wales.
Danny Davis, yeah.
I don't know what he's got, but it actually sounds like he's using a proper microphone, doesn't it?
It does. I've heard his calls before, and I'm amazed at the clarity of them.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, really good, really good. Yeah, so before you go, have you got another job that you could suggest for Tony Blair? Because that's another thing I'm going to do today. We're collect suggestions of jobs for Tony Blair.
Jobs for Tony Blair, let's see.
I've already suggested, of course, the obvious one, McDonald's, but not on the front, because I think it'd just upset people at the front.
I think he could be a tanker driver for you know the machines that go around and unblock drains that suck all the waste away.
Oh, with the big pipe on the end, it sucks all the rubbish up.
Yeah, because I mean, let's face it, he'd be driving around a vehicle with politicians' promises in it.
So a tanker driver for sucking out drains, yes. Thanks for the call, Adam.
Cheers, Chris.
All right, cheerio now. Adam the plumber calling in for you there, boys and girls. Yes. A tanker driver for sucking out the rubbish from drains. I like that suggestion. Maybe you've got a suggestion for a job for Tony Blair. Call in and let me know. 020-8144-3477 or Skype in on United Kingdom Talk, okay? 020-8144-3477 or Skype in on United Kingdom Talk. Joanna says, I always pick up my dog mess in a bag and bring home and throw away. I've reported dog mess left on ground while walking my dog. Oh, yeah, but did you report the person? You know, it's all very well reporting the dog mess, but you need to get the person as well. Because they just do it again. There was a bloke round here who used to do it. Great big dog. He used to end up in the middle of my front lawn. Outrageous. And then my neighbour caught him and had a word with him. Not my neighbour next door, but a neighbour who lives just across there. He caught him and went up to him. Because my neighbour don't care. He just tells them. He just tells them. You know, and he's not a big bloke, but he just tells them. He's very good, my neighbour. What's his name? John. Good neighbour. Good morning to Doug, who's watching this morning from Thailand. Good morning, Doug. Oh, is that Bet's nice weather over there at the moment? It's not cold outside, actually. As soon as I finish the show, I'll be going for a little walk up to the swimming pool. I can't go early swimming on a Saturday because they have things like water babies, where little babies, which is, I think, is an excellent idea, taking babies of just a few months old swimming. You know, because there's no fear then. I think the earlier people get in that swimming pool, the better. You get these little babies in there with special nappies. Thank God for that, dear. Because they can't control themselves, those babies, can they? Oh, my God. Just imagine if you're swimming in the pool and one of those think, oh, no. Oh, the thought is dreadful. Morning to Daniel, who is with us this morning. Good morning, Daniel. Down here in Camberley. And Joanna says, I called the police while I'm out seeing this. Good girl. Good girl. You call the police. We need to clean up Britain and the rest of the world while we're at it as well. Yes. Now, let me have a look. Of course, you could also report, I suppose, bad parking and things like that. Take photos. Now, last night, I came round the corner down there on the gap between one had parked one side and one, and they were quite close. And I couldn't get round the corner. I had to reverse and straighten up and go forward. You know, fire engines or things like that, they could not get there, could they? They could not get round there. Nice to see my sister Sharon Butler looks like she's taking over Facebook Live. She has now done 2 Facebook Live videos, although not the same as this. My shows, I kind of sit in front and do most of the talking myself. She does filming mainly of my little great nieces and great nephews. This morning they were singing that song. Do you remember this one? It's a mystery, oh, it's a mystery. Do you remember that? I can't remember who that's by. Anyone remember that? It's a mystery? Not quite sure on that one. Yes. It's a mystery. And George, who's 4 years old, he likes Alleluia. Alleluia. Not that awful one by Alexandra Burke. Oh, and Rufus Sumner House. Oh, I hate that one when they do that at karaoke. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, I can't bear it. It's one of those awful X Factor records at Christmas. And they're the same blooming thing all the time. The winner is brought onto the stage and they sing the most dreary song you could imagine. Halfway through that, a group of nuns come on and join in. And on the next chorus, a group of school children come in. And the lights dim and there's supposed to be tears in everyone's eyes because it's all so wonderful. But it's not. It's dreary and boring. Bring back. Oh, I wish it could be Christmas. What's happened to Happy Christmas Records? Although there was one done a couple of years ago by Geraldine. Do you remember that one? Geraldine. But it never really came back again. I thought that was going to come back again, but it didn't. We need Happy Christmas. I don't know how we got into Christmas at this time of the day. Good morning to Gustav. It's Toya. Thank you very much, Toya. I appreciate that, Toya. Thank you. Callum says, I'm still offended. By what, Callum? Callum is offended because he didn't get a United Kingdom Talk mug. There's none left, I'm afraid, Callum. I did ask who wanted one on the show, but you weren't watching. If you'd have told me you wanted one, you would have got one. I'm sorry, Callum. You've got to get in earlier. Can you not share your... we don't share things with our sisters, do we, really? Brothers and sisters don't share things until they're older. Then we start sharing things. That's true, Callum. You know, whenever I go up north to see my sister... We're actually going up north next weekend just for a day. for my nephew. And my nephew and his wife are doing a renewal of wedding vows ceremony. Have you ever done one of those? Have you ever been to one of those? Never even heard of it, have you? No, neither had we before we were told. A renewal of wedding vows next Saturday. And I'm doing the reading. How wonderful. I'm considering mucking about a little bit with it. I don't know if she'll be upset, but I think we need a bit of a laugh in church, don't we? We need to have a bit of laugh in church, and that will be at St. Peter's Church next Saturday in Woodhall Spa at 4:30. I think you should all come. I think you should all come to my nephew and his wife's renewal of wedding vows. And then when I get up and do the reading, when I finish, you can all clap. Wouldn't it be lovely to pack the church out with United Kingdom Talk viewers and listeners? I like the sound of that, lovey. Yes. Sorry, Callum. Yeah, Gustav says it's Toya. You're quite right, Gustav. It's a mystery. It's a mystery. That one. They were singing that this morning on the video. Oh, it was lovely. Would you like me to repost that later on for you? I will do. Shania says, Dad says it's good to hear you talking about rubbish as usual. Yes, well, Vectis, who is Shania's dad, he's a rubbish, what are they called? Refuse collector. No, not picking up. He drives the big vans. You know, with the thing at the back. So noisy in the morning, Vectis. Can we please have quiet rubbish trucks, if you don't mind? You hear that thing opening and closing, didn't you? And you hear things being crushed as it comes down. As they chuckle a load of stuff in. We got wheelie, but well, I think everyone's got wheelie bands in and wheelie bins in. And somehow they attach them. I think there's some sort of attachment on the back of the rubbish truck. I don't. What did we use it? What did we call it when as child? Rubbish truck. We never called it refuse. Rubbish man. The rubbish man. That's it. The rubbish man. The rubbish man's coming round to that. And when I lived in my place in, or when I lived with my mum and dad in our place in Roehampton, it would come round. I think twice a week actually, because we lived in flats. And I'd have that. I think they're called paladins, are they? The big metal things like that. And come and empty those, and the noise in the morning. And it was actually a nice noise. It would come round ever so early, and I'd be in bed. And as I woke up, we'd hear this noise. And it was kind of a really comforting noise, strangely enough. To hear this old rubbish cart going around, collecting the bins, and making all that clutter in. And of course, we had no central heating in houses in those days. And you wouldn't want to get up. You poke your, because I'm sure it was colder in the 70s anyway. You'd poke your finger out of your blanket, and there were no duvets. We didn't have duvets. It was all blankets and sheets. You'd poke your little nose out, and your nose would get cold, and it would go back up. I don't know, under again. Mum used to come in before I went to school, and we had a fan heater, which she would put on, plug in, and switch on before she woke me up, just to warm up the room a little bit. Like you couldn't warm me up much in 2 minutes. Oh, it was so cold in those days. Joanna says, I can't stand people leaving dog mess, especially when I'm always picking mine up. I'm sure you are, my darling, especially while walking their dogs. They do it all the time, don't they? They are disgusting to leave that dog mess there. Joanna also says, I could never only have trash pick up every 2 weeks. We have ours picked up every week. We only get ours picked up every 2 weeks now, although it is separated, I must say. So 1 week, they take household refuse like old food, cat litter. Half my bin is cat litter. Cat litter and newspaper with cat poo in it. Oh, it's awful. Oh, and that's the worst smell in it, cat poo. Oh, dear. Oh, sometimes if I get home from work, you know, and she'd gone a lot earlier, by the time you open the door, the smell was gone. I mean, where does the smell go? That's a thing. So she lives in the kitchen, my cat, which is warm enough, you know, got heating and all that. And the floor is now covered in newspaper. I have to keep doing that because she doesn't use the toilet anymore in the tray. I don't think she can find it. I don't know. And if I go in, sometimes there's one there and it's not smelling. You know, presumably, she went ages ago and the smell's gone. Where does the smell go? That's the question. Where does the smell go? Isn't that strange and mysterious? Someone has... Oh, wait, just a minute. What's that now? Just a minute. Isn't that strange and mysterious? Where has the smell gone? The kaboom. Yeah. So sometimes it's gone. So you have to carefully pick it up and wrap it up. But you mustn't squash it. Because the moment you squash it, it starts stinking again. Oh, dreadful. Poor old Katie the cat. So I pick up mine all the time as well. All right. I turned on the telly today. And it was lovely. British Airways staff are going on strike again. British Airways staff are really not happy. They're really unhappy at the moment. I don't know. There must be another bloke running it now because they're all very, very upset. There's one bloke I know who works on business class on British Airways, and he's trying to get another job now. He said he can't make any money. Apparently, they pay them by the hour. You know, so no work, no money. Terrible. What on earth happened to British Airways? They used to be renowned the world over. They were the world's most favourite airline. What the hell happened to British Airways? And it's a bloody shame. It really is. Because the times I've been, they do their best. I hate long haul flying. I hate it. Don't matter what, whether you're in the back or the front or upstairs. I hate flying. Not scared of it. I just hate it. It's so inconvenient and so uncomfortable. Even on the flatbeds, you like that. You like that. You can't stretch out. Yeah, and I suppose you could stretch out. Is it Emirates? They have an apartment in the sky, which really is. It's like your own little flat. And you get on the plane and you've got double bed. Double bed, you stretch out and just go to sleep. No problem at all. That's how it's nice to fly. Yeah, if you've got about 30 grand, one way. One way, dear. That's how I'd like to fly. Yes, please. Thank you very much. But it was nice to see an old British Airways advert this morning on Sky News. It's the one that goes, do you want me to play it? I've got it here somewhere. One moment, please. I'll bring it up on my system. One moment, please. Let's British Airways. I've played this before if you're you. Here we are, British Airways, 1970s. You ready? Here we go. British Airways advert. Oh, yes. That was my favourite British Airways advert ever. It was nice to see that on Sky News last night. The old union. Oh, that's what I meant to tell. So last night, in my bag of many things that I take around with me to work, I found a mini Union Jack flag, which I put out on my little thing, just put it up there. So that's it. The night came and went. And right at the end, when someone was packing away, a regular, who will remain nameless, complained. I said, well, what's wrong with that? He said, you're upsetting the Europeans in here. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, we're very cosmopolitan here. Well, what's that got to do with anything? And he went on. I said, look, I'm not here to talk politics. And he went on and on. I said, look, I'm not going to talk to you. I'm not going to talk to you. We don't do politics in here. I'm here to entertain. It's just a flag. He was, of course, was he foreign? No, usual. Middle-aged white Englishman. Middle-aged white Englishman who saw it necessary to complain on behalf of other people who hadn't complained. There were no other complaints. No one came up to me. No one looked at it in a funny way. Only the white middle-aged Englishman. Now, we had a similar incident to this somewhere else this week where I was watching with a certain drag queen. Again, no names mentioned. Okay. And she was saying something. I can't remember what it was. And I can't remember what it was. And some white, in this case, younger, white boy, young man, white young man shouted at her that she was racist. Of course, she's like, well, what was racist about that? So he was going on and on. And then two black lads, he said, well, we don't think it was racist. You know, what is this about the bloody lefties who seem to think it's wonderful to keep complaining on other people's behalf? Shut your bloody mouths, because we're not interested anymore. We are sick to death of that sort of thing. You and your offence all the time. So there we are. Someone was offended last night by the Union Jack, but I walked away not being bored with, not bringing all that up there. No, thank you very much. Now, let me see. What else have we got here? Another couple of stories for you this morning. A very good programme coming up on BBC One Colour this weekend. Now, you may remember a few years ago, and wherever you were in the world, you should probably have got this story. A drugs trial was done here in London. Now, it was a number of... Oh, it was much longer, further back than... Do you know, it's funny when you see these news stories and they go back much further than you remember, you know? Sometimes you're like, oh, that was a couple of years ago. Well, get this. 2006, that's 6, 7, that's 11 years ago this was. 11 years ago this was. On a hospital ward, in March 2006... 8 volunteers signed up for a medical trial in London. None of the 8 volunteers could have known what lay ahead for them. It became known as the Elephant Man trial because of its shocking side effects. And there's going to be a new BBC documentary on this week, revisiting the dramatic events that left men fighting for their lives. And I remember this story. I could read it all from the paper. Let me do it from memory, because it's like more personal. And I remember this thing appearing on the news. So these men went in for this drugs trial. And you can often see these advertised. Drugs companies wanting to do drugs trials with people. And often you can make an awful lot of money very quickly. Now, I was going out with someone once, and he did a drugs trial for headache tablets. And what he had to do was go into this clinic for a couple of days, right? They would inject him with something that brought on a bad headache, and then give him tablets to see what happened. And I said, what was it like? He said, oh, it was the most awful headache. But the tablets worked, and then when it's done, you get, I think he got 2,000, I think he got £1,000. £1,000. You know, but at what cost to your health? On the side of the drugs companies, it has to be said, by the time they've tested it on humans, it's the end of the line. You know, by the time they're testing it on humans, they're 99.9% sure that nothing bad is going to happen. These things are old. They don't want you to die, do they? Of course they don't. Going to cost them a fortune. Paying out to your missus or your children or something like that. But that's how it works. They test on machines, and I have to say animals as well, I'm sure they do. Right? And then right at the end of the line, the final part of it is to test stuff on humans. So these are eight, I think they were young men, actually. They were all quite young men, I believe. The group between 19 and 34 had signed up to take part in the phase one trial, meaning they were the first humans to test this drug, OK? Having been successfully tested on monkeys, I know we're not going down that line at the moment, expectations were high. They were split into two groups of four, with one in each receiving a placebo. Now, a placebo... That's something that doesn't do anything for you. Might as well be eating a Smartie, okay? So it doesn't do anything. But one doesn't know. They don't know who's got that one and who's got that one. It's just given to all of them, okay? The atmosphere was relaxed and lighthearted. A friend of mine had done trials, this bloke says. They were offering £2,000. It's a lot of money, £2,000. And I thought that was okay, he said. I was interested in the scientific contribution I would be making. It was a medicine being tested in a laboratory approved by the government. This is a guy called Rob Oldfield, who was 31 at the time. What could go wrong? And there's some of the other blokes there. It tells you all about them. And they were given this drug. And for a few people, nothing happened, of course. The placebo. For others, it went seriously wrong. Seriously wrong. They were screaming in agony. Doctors were running around, not knowing what to do. They had to ferry in, they had to go and get other doctors. And of course, they're dealing with something that they'd never dealt with before. Their bodies were shutting down. They were literally screaming in agony, these people. Anyway, the programme's on BBC One Colour this week. And it's on, I think, Thursday. It's on... Oh, what's that now? Just a minute. I do hate what? That.
I can't have cancer.
I do hate that when the blooming videos start playing before you've done it. The drug trial emergency at the hospital is on BBC Two Colour at 9 o'clock on Tuesday night. OK, so that'd be well worth watching, that programme. All right, the drug trial emergency at the hospital on BBC... I'm going to write that down, actually. On BBC Two Colour. BBC Two on Tuesday night at 9 o'clock, all right? One to watch out for there. Okie doke. Anyone else want to call in quickly today? Then please feel free to do so. It's 020-8144-3477. I'm going to disappear in a minute because it's time to go swimming. 020-8144-3477. Okay. Let's do today's birthdays then. It's birthday to... Oh, hang on a minute. Some messages from the last show we did. Mark. Hello, Mark Cobain says he loves Five Guys, where I keep dropping by there on a Wednesday night after I finished the quiz. I did offer to buy Ray Reynolds a Five Guys, but he wasn't interested. He couldn't wait to get out that door when he'd won the quiz. He went with his £30 gift card. Joanna says, I am a Shake Lee Corporation distributor. We were talking about vitamin tablets the other day. And I take several vitamins and minerals. Please make sure that the vitamins you take contain the proper amount of the actual vitamin. Most contain a lot of fillers and a small amount of vitamin. Then the vitamin will not work. So there's a question for you. If I was to buy some vitamin D tablets, which brand should I be looking at? Bearing in mind that the brands in the UK are probably different from the brands in the USA, aren't they? Which brand should I buy, Joanna? I don't know. Anyone got any suggestions there? Angela says, lovely and delicious. Thanks for the birthday shout out, Chris. We did meet in Orlando in January 2014. That's when I was in Orlando with my nephew. What a wonderful, wonderful holiday in Florida we had. I went to see the, not my nephew, but I went to see the Barry Manilow concert that was in town on that day. Simon, we talked about Butlins as well on the last show. Simon says, I worked a whole season at Butlins Bognor, 1998. Okay, so that's not too far back, is it? 1998. I worked in the plaza where all the carvery and food outlets. My favourite job I had there was when I was working in the pot wash. Working in the pot wash, yeah? Getting your pot washed today. Take on a car wash song. Da-da car wash. That one you were singing away. And that's what I used to sing while working in there. Much to the amusement of everyone. And the plaza had Billy Butlin's actual car in the window. Great times, Mr. Chop Chop. I reckon you had a really good time doing that. I'd quite like to work in Butlins or Pontins, something like that, maybe. Let's do today's birthdays. Happy birthday to Skylar Baker Jordan, 31 years old today. That's a nice age, 31. Happy birthday to you, sir. Austyn Biggers, it's Austyn Biggers' birthday today. Happy birthday, Austyn. Tony Dino Corrigan is 57 years old today. Happy birthday, Tony. And Anita, lovely Anita. One of Barry Manilow's girls. It's her birthday as well today. I won't read out your age, Anita. I'm not sure. I think sometimes ladies don't want their ages read out. So happy birthday, Anita. Anita's actually got a tattoo of Barry Manilow on her arm. Yes, she has a tattoo of Barry Manilow. They're today's birthdays. Now, we weren't here yesterday. Shall I do yesterday's birthdays as well while I'm here? I think I should. Calendar, what is it? 18, so 17... Oh, there was only one yesterday. Sarah Paul. It was her birthday yesterday. And she was 31. So happy birthday to you all, boys and girls. Here comes the song. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. All right. Happy birthday. Saturday night tonight, the 18th of February 2017. I'll be doing a little bit of DJing and hosting Cabaret tonight at Central Station in Wharfdale Road, King's Cross. I'm there most Saturdays now. I recently picked up most of the Saturdays there, all right? So that's where I am tonight. Just one more little comment from Joanna, who says the Shakely Corporation is available in the UK. If interested, you could look it up, or I can always find someone for you. So thank you very much for Joanna. I appreciate that, my darling. I shall actually look up there. I think vitamin D, maybe vitamin C as well. My mate takes loads of these vitamin tablets. I think he takes the multivitamin type thing, yeah. That's it today. Thank you very much for joining us, and I'll see you again on a show very soon. Have a lovely day. Bye-bye now.